Good morning, adventurers. My name is Ben, and welcome to a morning show where I sit around, drink some tea, and talk about D&D. First things first, inside of the mug, the mug itself today, first, is the greatest uncle in the universe mug. It felt kind of weirdly appropriate for what we're talking about, but like, not quite at the same time. It seemed to make sense. And inside of it, we have some Wildberry Zinger from Celestial Seasonings. Once again, very, very good. It's like a berry-y kind of tea. I don't know. It's very good, though. I do like it a lot. And I highly recommend it if you are into a fruitier kind of tea. Anyway, getting into what we're talking about today, because I am so psyched about this one. I'm so jazzed. Jazzed, if you will. And I can't even really explain why. But it's got me, like, hooked in the brain, and I have to talk about it. And there just aren't that many people I can actually talk about it with. So, what we're talking about today. Why EXU Calamity might be the best Critical Role show yet. And why Brennan Lee Mulligan is one of the pivotal reasons for that. Anyway, getting into it. So, if you are unaware for one reason or another, EXU Calamity, Exandria Unlimited Calamity, is a four-part miniseries airing on Critical Role's channel. They went ahead and they started it a few weeks ago now. We're going to talk about it in at the end of this, at the end of this episode, we're going to talk about when they air their final episode, because it's on Thursday. They have gone three parts in so far, and they have one more coming up. It has been so good. It has been so incredibly good. I can't really explain it any better way than that. It has just been so, so, so good. And they made all the perfect choices for this miniseries. And it's phenomenal. And we're going to talk about why it's phenomenal. First things first, it might be the best show that's been on Critical Role's channel. Fully my opinion. Fully, fully my opinion. I adore the main campaigns. I adore them with all my heart. I genuinely don't think that there's actually going to be any way that Calamity can, like, unseat one of those because of the long, like, deep-rooted character growth into my heart and everything like that. But, far and away, my favorite miniseries, one-shot, etc., anything like that they have done so far. And assuming they stick the landing, which Brennan usually does, I am so psyched to see how this thing wraps up on Thursday. So, fully my opinion on that one, but here's why I do think that it is my favorite so far of all of their little stuff. One, and maybe most importantly, I really love high-level D&D play. I love getting to see characters just rip off these crazy, crazy spells, these crazy, crazy abilities. And the thing is, they're pretty much all spellcasters. So these crazy spells, there you go. I love getting to see things like that happen. And not have it be some crazy massive deal where everybody stands up and screams, even if they do that anyway, but one person does it, and then on the next turn, the next person will do it the exact same way. High-level D&D is so cool to me, and you don't get to see it represented all that much because it is so much easier to run a show when you are playing at a lower level. Just because combat moves faster and you focus more on the role-playing aspect of it, which is the part that people tune in for on a show. So, personally, I adore the high-level stuff. Paired with that is the casting on this. The only person I didn't know going into it was Luis, and he has been incredible. Absolutely phenomenal. The casting on this is... I was comfortable with all of them already, which I think is a big part of it, but I adore every single one of them, and I adore every single one of their characters. They have put so much emotional labor into these characters for a four-part miniseries that it is genuinely kind of absurd. But I get the feeling that they got the call. Well, I say they got the call. The creative director and the CEO are sitting at the table. So they got the call saying, hey, we're going to do this show. And everybody jumped on and was like, well, we got to pitch these characters. We got to be the ones at the table. So... There is a combination of things. Those two, in conjunction with the fact that this era has always been fascinating to me, the concept of the Age of Arcanum in Matt's universe. Something that I've always loved, something that I've always been absolutely entranced by, and something that I've always really wanted to see. Part of the reason I think that I really actually enjoyed the Aeor arc, in spite of the fact that it was very, very long for no discernible reason, in Campaign 2. Anyway, let's get into it a little bit deeper now. From here on out, I'm going to say that there is an open spoiler warning for the episodes 1 through 3 of EXU Calamity. Potentially the main campaigns, but probably not. I don't think I'm going to hit any Dimension 20 spoilers, but fair warning that, like, I'm going to be talking details, I'm going to be talking about specifics, I'm going to be drawing comparisons. Okay? Cool? All on the same page? Awesome. Getting into it. The opening scene where Brennan, Matt likes to do a lot of like exposition, massive, massive world build, lots of like imagery, things that sort of really help set the world up. Brennan instead dives straight to the character. With the exception of the fact that the first word out of his mouth, I'm pretty sure, is fire. But then he asks Luis, the likely across the board least known character, least known player sitting at the table, to describe his character while keeping in mind that he has a mouthful of blood. What? That's amazing. That's a fantastic start. And that sort of brings me to, I touched on it teeny tiny bit as I intro'd that bit. The reason that I think Brennan is the single best choice they could have had for this style of campaign. Brennan Lee Mulligan is the master of the short game as far as I am concerned, as far as a lot of people are concerned. Matthew Mercer, arguably the best DM for long game stuff. He holds these incredible, massive storylines that are 50, 60, 70 episodes deep, even more. You know, if you watch Campaign 1 of Critical Role, you hear stuff about the Whispered One as early as the 20th episode, stretching all the way through the end. Like, It's incredible how deep he can root those stories and weave them through and make a through line in such a way that actually is useful for him to tell the story. On the other hand, the little arcs that he has in there don't always land as well as they should be because they are feeding into that larger story. So the individual arcs might fall flat, but they do feed into a final product that is greater than the sum of its parts in that capacity. However, we have not gotten to see Brennan run a game that is longer than, I want to say, 25 episodes, 24 episodes, something like that. All we know is Brennan's short game. Again, short game is relative in that context, but 4 episodes, that's a short game. He's run plenty of 4-episode, 6-episode, 8-episode arcs on Dimension 20. He has absolutely crushed them every single time. They are both immaculate storytellers. However, I genuinely don't know that Matt could be pulling off the story in the way that Brennan is, in spite of the fact that Brennan is the one who has built the world. Matt is the one who has built the world. Brennan has come in and taken what Matt has done and run with it. He is just so aware of what to focus on and how to focus on in a tight timeline game that it is just beyond masterful in the way that he's telling the story. Pairing that with the fact that he has gone to the effort of understanding every inch of this world that he has been placed in means that he can do anything within it. The players at the beginning say that he sent them a 20-page lore document. I would guess that that is a minor exaggeration, and it was actually more like 18 pages, because with the amount of raw information that he is throwing out there like it's nothing, and having the players actually respond in a way that makes it seem like they understand, that tells me that he is not pulling those out of thin air. He actually knows what he's talking about with regard to all of those names, all of those places, all of those things that he's talking about, and that is mind-blowing. Genuinely, that is an aspirational DM kind of thing. That's incredible. I kind of touched on it earlier. Brennan focuses in on characters as well. And while Matt does have ample time for characters to develop, ample beautiful story arcs for all these characters, Brennan, in the short game, sits down, takes a look at it, and goes, all right, we're going to zero in here, and then we're going to zero in here on all of these individual characters that these players have put so much love into now. And it's just, I mean, the characters are heartbreaking at this point. The most recent episode, episode 3, again, spoilers if you're still here for some reason, when they got into the PvP at the end of the episode, oh my god, it was heartbreaking to watch, but it was riveting. It could not be better. He moved combat forward in such a quick manner that it didn't feel like combat. He withheld the information from Luis as he was going through it because he wanted to make sure that everybody was about to get absolutely just like crushed by what was going on. He has so wonderfully taken these characters and picked out the things that they wanted to, or the things that they want as characters. Lou actually yells at one point at Abria, I thought I was going to be you in this campaign, because he thought he was going to be the crazy person in this campaign and not the guy that got sucked into trying to stop everybody from breaking the universe. And that's incredible, because they have all settled so well into these roles at this point too, but these roles that have happened organically by or as a result of him digging in and drilling in. It's phenomenal. It's so good. I want to see him run a long game so that I can get a more direct comparison between him and Matt, but I also understand that, like, that just, we don't need to be comparing them to start, but I do want to see that. The other thing is, and this is more of a style thing, Matt and Brennan have very similar styles. However, Matt's style is very flowery, very descriptive, very expository, if you will. Brennan's is very detail-oriented and very, very fast. Matt will sit and he will set the scene, he will describe all of these things, he will really build out the world around the characters as they have walked into this place. Brennan tells you the information you need to know as soon as you get in there, and you just keep going. And it might be his whole coffee thing, but like, he is in, he's going, he's moving the whole time. When he takes a pause, it is an intentional pause, and it is terrifying too. And that really helps add to the weight of everything that is going on. When he slows down his random sort of expository talking, it becomes grave and weighty just by nature of him slowing down and looking and talking. And that's all he has to do. And he just, oh my god, he makes the air so heavy when he does it. It's so good. It's so good. I am adoring every second of it. Plus, the final thing, and again, it really does kind of highlight how close in style he and Matt are. But Brennan knows every rule in that book. Like, every single one of them, pretty much. And if he doesn't, he has his computer right in front of him, ready to look something up. No problems at all. And it really puts an emphasis, in my mind at least, because it's something that I notice, on the rules that he chooses to follow and the rules he chooses not to follow. He says a couple of times, I'm going to make a homebrew ruling here with the way that these things are going to interact. I'm going to make a homebrew ruling here because I think you've picked something super cool to counter this with. And he can do that on the fly because he doesn't have to stop and go, okay, well, how is this supposed to work? And do I want it to work that way? And should I have it work that way? No, he can go from we're doing these two things through all those steps, lightning fast, to this is the answer. And Matt can do the same kind of thing, but Matt will get bogged down in the rules a little bit more. Brennan, more often, will just go, all right, we're going. And he'll either say yes or no in a snap like that, which is really, really fantastic. I am adoring this show. I am so excited for when the last episode comes out tomorrow. Please go check it out. It's so good. I can't wrap my head around it. I just can't. I wish that I could, but it's so good. It's So, so good. Anyway, that's what I have to talk to you guys about on that. Getting into what shows we have today and tomorrow, we have, hilariously, Dimension 20, not with Brendan. Instead, it's Coffin Run, which is also a lot of fun. Knocked Prone, Venture Maidens, Trials and Trebuchets, and Roll Out. And then on Thursday, as has been mentioned many a time this episode, we have Critical Role, Authors and Dragons, NADPOD, and LGBT D&D. Please go check them out. Please let them know that I sent you, because again, at some point somebody's going to say something to me about it, and I'm going to think that it is hysterical. Whether or not it actually is yet to be seen, but we have to see it in order to find out. Great. Yes. That is everything I have to talk to you guys about today. So, thank you so much for making me part of your morning... Let's try that again. Thank you so much for making me part of your morning routine. I really do appreciate it. And thank you so much in particular to my patrons. You guys are the ones that make this show possible. If you're interested in becoming a patron, check out the link in the description of this episode. I really do appreciate all the support, and I appreciate you guys even just sticking through this part of the episode, because I know it's just the wrap-up and kind of boring. But with all that said, don't forget, everybody, drink tea, play D&D, and keep on rolling.